Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Narasimha. So I will be speaking about benzodiazepine withdrawal for next 20 to 25 minutes. So this is the outline of my presentation. The outline will be, I'll be giving a brief introduction about benzodiazepine dependence, specifically with related to withdrawal. And I'll be telling about the types of dependence, because recently we had a question about what are the different types of dependence which is there. And what is the neurobiology of withdrawal? Why does withdrawal happen? Clinical features of withdrawal. And what is the most useful scale that can be applied? And what is the treatment? And what is the prevention? How do you prevent a person getting into dependence? So even though my topic is about withdrawal, slightly I'll stretch beyond the withdrawal so that I can cover some of the aspects which are very important to management of withdrawal. So as you all know that benzodiazepines are all over the world, the most commonly prescribed and abused psychopharmaceuticals. And most of the people ask this question, does benzodiazepine cause a high? Yes, because GABA interneurons, which are acted by benzodiazepine, also stimulates ventral tegmental area, which produces a high in people who abuse benzodiazepine. That is one of the reasons why people become dependent on benzodiazepine. Second, there are different other reasons why people also become dependent on benzodiazepine. But to tell you that benzodiazepines also cause high, this is one of the mechanism. Then coming to the special characteristic of benzodiazepine is, even at low dose, that is even at a smaller doses, take 2 mg of clonazepam, 1 mg of alprazolam, even at small doses, physical and mental dependence can develop even without without the presence of tolerance. That is, in the absence of tolerance also, people can become dependent both physically and mentally on benzodiazepine. The third important thing is withdrawal symptoms prolong benzodiazepine use, which is one of the important reason for continuation of benzodiazepine use. And one more specific term which we need to know is, like Deepthadi has posed a question, that 3 months is the 3 months is beyond 3 months. If you prescribe benzodiazepine, then chances of becoming dependent is high. In that context, the long-term use is not synonymous to dependence, but the long-term use, there is no standard definition, but most of the studies has mentioned that 6 to 12 months of usage, more than beyond 6 to 12 months of usage, has been considered as long-term use. So coming to diagnosis of dependence, as you all know, ICD-10 and DSM-5 criteria are basically used for diagnosis of dependence, and I'm not going to do that. And comorbid drug use and dosage of benzodiazepine, past complications are very important when you are diagnosing benzodiazepine dependence. So basically, even though there is a lot of overlap between these three things, these three types of dependent population, that is, one, therapeutic dependence, two, prescribed high dose dependence, three, recreational benzodiazepine abuse. Therapeutic dependence is what Dr. Sharanya madam was pointing out, that these are the people who are prescribed benzodiazepine for specific reason, that is, given at 1 mg or 2 mg. And they continue to take these drugs for a longer period of time. These constitute more than 50% of the people who become dependent on benzodiazepine. So this is the largest group of population who are dependent or abusing benzodiazepine. Even though the term has been changed in current DSM-5, but these are people who tend to continue using benzodiazepine. The second is prescribed high dose. You prescribe them 1 mg, but they, as days progress, they go on to 2 mg, 3 mg, 4 mg, and they keep on repeating the prescription, changing the doctors. So this is the second type of dependence that you see. The third is recreational benzodiazepine use. These are typical polysubstance dependent usage. That is, even though you can also tell in the previous case that the person has been using in a recreational manner. Apart from that, people who are taking typically opioids in combination of benzodiazepine, other benzodiazepine also called as downers, because it helps the stimulant, the effect of stimulant, to come down and also prevent the some of the withdrawal symptoms. So coming to the neurobiology of withdrawal, the basic problem with why withdrawal symptoms happen is, over a period of time tolerance develop. As tolerance develop, a lot of neuroadaptation happens. Once a person stops benzodiazepine, which unmasks the drug-induced neuroadaptations, which causes withdrawal symptoms. Basically, the withdrawal symptoms is because of underactivity of GABA and surge of glutamate or positive CNS activity. And these adaptations you have to know that these adaptations are very slow to recover. That is, these do not recover. Sometimes it takes a very long time, that is maybe months, or sometimes it also leads to protracted nature of withdrawal symptoms. Maybe on day one, day two, you may not see withdrawal symptoms, but it starts from day three and it can continue for months together. So what are the withdrawal symptoms? So if you see faster acting, if you see short, there is a difference between onset of withdrawal symptoms. That is, with respect to shorter acting agent, these withdrawal symptoms start very fast, that is 2 to 3 days, and longer acting agents take a fairly longer time for onset of withdrawal symptoms. And most withdrawal symptoms are because of, as I already told, brain hyperexcitability. And withdrawal symptoms can be classified into physical, psychological, and sensory symptoms. And mildest form of withdrawal symptoms is rebound symptoms. That is, a person has been given medication for sleep, he might have insomnia. If a person has been given medication for anxiety, he might have rebound anxiety. So the most common physical withdrawal symptoms are muscle tension, weakness, spasms, pain, influenza-like symptoms like sweating, shivering, pins and needles. And most common psychological withdrawal symptoms include anxiety, panic-like symptoms, restlessness, agitation, depression, mood swings, other psychovegetative symptoms like tremors, reduced concentration, sleep disturbances, nightmares. And there are other symptoms like appetite loss, tachycardia, blurred visions, which are not very common but can be seen. Apart from that, there can be perceptual abnormalities like hyperacusis to photophobia to dysesthesia. And they, people can have symptoms like seizures, which are again can be life-threatening sometimes, and which requires intensive management. There can be symptoms of delirium or minor perceptual abnormalities like hallucinations, depersonalization, and sometimes paranoid thoughts. There are certain set of symptoms which are slightly more characteristic of benzodiazepine withdrawal. When you see patients with benzodiazepine withdrawal in comorbidity with alcohol withdrawal, in comorbidity with opioid withdrawal. So how do you differentiate some of the symptoms when compared to alcohol withdrawal or general anxiety symptoms? So some of the symptoms, like which is on the right side of the screen, like benzodiazepine withdrawal usually have some of the symptoms like muscle twitches, jerks, fasciculations, tinnitus, and some of these perceptual abnormalities like distortion of body image, tingling, numbness, altered sensation. So the symptoms on the right side seems to be more characteristic of benzodiazepine when compared to general anxiety like symptoms. So these are the symptoms. So next, coming to the assessment, first thing we need to do is confirm the usage, whether a person has been using benzodiazepine or not. Because lot of the people come seeking for benzodiazepine because they know that if you come to a psychiatrist might give you something replacement for benzodiazepine use. Whether you may not be knowing whether the person has been taking benzodiazepine or not. So one of the easiest way is doing a car test. Car test for benzodiazepine, some of the benzodiazepine may not give positive on car test. So you can also do a quantification. If these facilities are not available, then clinical test is also given in modulator tolerance test. So see, give a small doses of diazepam, either 10 mg or 20 mg based on what person has been taking. So if you see for 2 to 3 hours, if the person is not sedated, it means that this dosage is not causing sedation, and you can empirically give 20 mg TID. So this is basically a tolerance test. Other clinical scale which can be used is CIVA-B. So this is a CIVA-B which includes a 20 item scale, out of which 17 are subjective and 3 are objective. The objective, that is clinical observation, based on clinical observation like behavior for sweating, restlessness, agitation, tremors, and looking for other signs of autonomic arousal. Apart from that, you also need to monitor certain other things when you are managing benzodiazepine withdrawal, like blood pressure, pulse rate, respiration, temperature, pupils, consciousness, and orientation, because most of the people, if not treated adequately, might go into a delirium. So if the scores are ranging from 1 to 20, which means mild withdrawal, 21 to 40, which means moderate withdrawal, 40 to 60, severe withdrawal, and 60 to 80, very severe withdrawal. And one of the practice that we follow here is do twice or thrice daily CIVA-B scales at least for 1 week till the patient is stable on benzodiazepine dose. So all benzodiazepine dependent patients, we regularly monitor CYB scores. Based on the CYB scores, we titrate the doses. So this is an excellent article which has been published in New England Journal of Medicine in March 2017. And this was published by Soika and Ashton. So these are two pioneers who has been working in treatment of benzodiazepine dependence. If you see all the guidelines which has been framed from 1995 to 2017-18, most of the guidelines includes the articles published by these two people, Soika and Ashton. So most of my presentation will be based on this article which has been published in 2017 March. And apart from that, there is one more article by Ashton. So based on next, till now I have dealt with what is the neurobiological basis followed by what is the clinical symptoms. Right now I will come to the, I also discussed about the investigation assessment. Now I am coming to the management, so which includes treatment. So the rate of withdrawal, the rate of patients withdrawal symptoms and also rate of withdrawal of the benzodiazepine depends on individual factors and the dose and type of benzodiazepine that has been used, reasons for prescription, personality issues, environmental stresses and amount of available support. These are certain factors which you need to keep in mind before you start medication and treatment. Even if you are admitting a patient or in an inpatient or outpatient setting, these are some of the factors which you need to keep in mind before taking any clinical decision. So first I will give an overview of all the studies which has been done in the area of benzodiazepine dependence. So all the studies on the top, if you look at all the studies, one which is very clear is should be discontinued gradually over a period of several weeks, not in number of days. And the dose reduction should be more than 4 to 6 weeks if the diazepam doses required to treat or the patient is dependent on equivalent doses of diazepam more than 30 mg. So this is what has been studied in most of the studies. This is the overview of all the Cochrane review and other oral consensus. Some of the basic principles in management is most of the time we read that if a person is dependent on any benzodiazepine, shift over to long acting agent, even though that has been followed and extremely useful, but current evidence suggests that it is not very clear whether we need to switch to a longer acting agent. And there are studies which also looked at blind reduction of benzodiazepine, that is without telling the patient reduce the benzodiazepine, but this has also been criticized significantly. Apart from that, when do you need to shift to a longer acting agent like diazepam? If a person has been dependent on several benzodiazepine, not a single benzodiazepine, then it is preferred to shift to a longer acting agent like diazepam. And what has been studied extensively or what has been proven extensively is if you fix the dose relatively, if you are fixed the dose and give a schedule that this is the period of time I am going to reduce the dose, then the amount of people coming out of this withdrawal seems to be high. And if the person is taking more than 100 mg of diazepam or equivalent doses, it is preferred to hospitalize the patient rather than treating on an OPD basis. So coming to the management, what studies have mentioned is that if a person has been taking short acting benzodiazepine, then the chances of dropout from the treatment loop seems to be higher than longer acting agent, but shifting from a shorter acting, shorter half-life medication to longer half-life medication doesn't seem to help in a good outcome. So as I already mentioned, the withdrawal rate is often determined by the person's capacity to tolerate the symptoms. Recommendations, how much do you give benzodiazepine or how much you taper, it ranges. There are a lot of guidelines which looked at how you need to taper, but we need to stick to a single guidelines. What most of the guidelines tell is 50% every week to reducing to 10 to 25% every 2 weeks. So this is the range of reduction that different guidelines follow. And different guidelines tell you taper by 4 to 6 weeks or 4 to 8 weeks. So we need to use our clinical precision and also individual factors how you are going to taper the benzodiazepine. So As I already mentioned, there are three types of dependence, basically therapeutic dose dependence and the other high dosage dependence. So how to manage therapeutic dose dependence? So there are a lot of studies which are done in therapeutic dose dependence. For example, a person has been taking 2 mg of clonazepam over a long period of time. So what is advised is simple written advice. There are studies which are done in 200 to 400 patients. Simple written advice. Give a advice, please kindly taper and stop benzodiazepine or stop your benzodiazepine use. Around more than 50% of the patients have stopped using benzodiazepine. Gradual tapering regimen. That is, boss, you go back and reduce the doses of benzodiazepine once in this many days. That also has helped. And so in therapeutic dose dependence, there is no need to, at least from the literature I reviewed, there is no need to shift over to other benzodiazepine, like shift over to diazepam or long-acting benzodiazepine. The same benzodiazepine can be tapered by 1/8 or 1/10 of a daily dose once in 1 to 2 weeks. And if there are other anxiety symptoms which are present, it can be converted to either diazepam or other longer acting agents which will help in anxiety symptoms also. When it comes to high dose abuse, the most of the guidelines which mention about high dose abuse is to better shift over to longer acting diazepam and then initially follow a rapid tapering regimen, at the end follow a slow tapering regimen. For your information, I also given the alternative, dose equivalents of benzodiazepine. So 0.5 mg of alprazolam is equivalent to 1 mg of lorazepam, which is equivalent to 10 mg of diazepam. So I only mentioned about alprazolam, lorazepam and diazepam because these are the most commonly used drugs by us. So this is from Maudsley, which mentions that reduce 10 mg every day, every 1 to 2 weeks, down till a patient reaches up to 50 mg. Then followed by 5 mg every day, every 1 to 2 weeks, down till up to 30 mg. Then 2 mg, then 1 mg. If you want to remember roughly about 1/8 of the dose per fortnight. So there are other drugs which can be used for management of benzodiazepine withdrawal, which can help benzodiazepines either, or which can be used alone but not recommended in case of high dose dependence. So antidepressants can be used if there is depression. There is evidence of using dopamine, trazodone, mirtazapine if chronic sleep disorder is present. Antihistaminics can be used if in case of sleep disturbances. Mood stabilizers, carbamazepine 200 mg BD has been tried. There is limited evidence for pregabalin, gabapentin, beta blockers, and there is a risk of abuse with pregabalin. Melatonin in case of sleep disturbances can be used. Flumazenil has been shown to be effective, which is an antagonist at benzodiazepine receptor, but the risk of seizures prevent using of flumazenil. In patients with opioid dependence, that is, this poses a significant risk. A patient is using opioids, a patient is using benzodiazepine, and if you treat both, then the chances of respiratory depression can be high. So how do you manage? So most of the studies tell that if a patient is in a stable dose of opioids, so continue that stable dose and treat for benzodiazepine dependence. If the patient is taking very high dosage of methadone, that is more than 150 milligrams, then you need to be extremely careful when you are giving benzodiazepine. For example, if a patient presented in opioid withdrawal and benzodiazepine withdrawal, again there is a significant amount of argument, but in clinical practice, opioid withdrawal is not life-threatening, but benzodiazepine withdrawal can be life-threatening. So go ahead treating benzodiazepine withdrawal first, followed by opioid withdrawal. But when it comes to buprenorphine, the chance of respiratory depression or overdose seems to be less. So when you are treating comorbidity like opioid dependence, primary psychiatric illness, a patient with schizophrenia using slightly higher dose of benzodiazepine or 2 mg of clonazepam, so should we taper or not taper? There comes the clinical dilemma, and which is also slightly difficult, whether you need to taper or not taper. Always we can think of using alternative options, but sometimes it may not be possible. So this is the level of evidence. If you see, for benzodiazepine in general, the level of evidence is high. use of several benzodiazepine, that is switching or gradual tapering, the level of evidence is high. Using benzodiazepine only, using diazepam only for detoxification, it's good. And apart from that, use of other agents like carbamazepine, antidepressant, the level of evidence is moderate. Pregabalin and gabapentin, is the level of evidence is low. And for cognitive behavior therapy, as an add-on to benzodiazepine withdrawal, it seems to be good. So what are the psychotherapeutic interventions and what are the goals? The goal of psychotherapeutic intervention would be to facilitate withdrawal itself, facilitate further abstinence, and treat the underlying disorder. So psychotherapeutic interventions range from single brief consult, that is already I spoke about giving a letter that please stop benzodiazepine, from cognitive behavioral therapy diverted towards anxiety management of stress, coping strategies. And these psychotherapeutic interventions, there is evidence for motivational interviewing, there is evidence for CBT, there is a meta-analysis which has done in 25 studies which looked at CBT versus motivational interviewing, in which CBT has found to be useful when compared to motivational interviewing. And eclectic behavioral therapy, eclectic therapy, that is use of different forms of therapy, has also been useful for management of withdrawal. The outcomes are very good. The outcomes of patient treatment for benzodiazepine withdrawal symptoms seems to be very good. 70 to 80% of them are able to stop if proper management was given. And the relapse rate seems to be somewhere between 8 to 50% in next 1 to 5 years. So how do you prevent? As we already discussed, don't prescribe benzodiazepine for not more than 1 to 2 months. And in case of prescribing, look for alternative kinds of medication for sleep, which doesn't have abusive potential. Careful evaluation whether the patient is increasing the dosage over a period of time, and frequent monitoring. Giving prescriptions for a short period of time helps in prevention. Apart from that, high risk groups, people who have past history of other drug dependence, should be carefully given. And people with personality disorders, especially certain personality disorder which have significant amount of impulsivity, has to be there should be care before giving the prescription. And extreme caution should be taken in case of older patients,